Christian Lord, guide my hand against your Roman popery!
And they may take our lives, but they'll never take our freedom!
We're on a mission from God.
Entitled. You want answers!
I want the truth! You can't handle the truth!
Maybe we should chug on over to Mamby Pamby Land, where maybe we can find some self-confidence for you, you jackwagon!
Coming to you live from his padded cell high atop Bethel Church, the most heralded, the most despised talk show in all of human history. This is the talk show Hell Hates. This is Pastor Mike Online.
And here we are coming to you live from our top secret broadcasting bunker. And right now, as I start broadcasting, I'm getting a phone call on my phone and it's saying spam risk. Should I answer it? Spam risk. Does anybody know somebody by the name of Spam Risk? And my question is, and I know a little bit more than the average computer user about computers, about how things work on them and so on, and their history and how things came to be, like what a computer virus is or what a Trojan horse is. But I've never been able to figure out why certain emails that come in, certain notifications that come in, phone calls that come in, why are they called spam? Never been able to figure that one out. Maybe somebody knows. I'm sure somebody knows. Somebody somewhere knows. But I don't. Good to be with you today. I am feeling very lethargical today. My bones ache again. I washed out my hot tub at home. I haven't used it since the fire we had last February. I drained all the water out of it, or most of it. All of it won't drain. So I decided the other day, to clean it out. I opened the top on it, and it's got these long strands of some kind of gunk growing in it. So I had to clean all that out. I haven't filled it back up yet, but I sure wish it was filled up. I'll probably fill it up this afternoon when I get home, but I won't be able to get in it because it'll be ice cold. So I'll have to wait for it to heat up. And it heats up pretty good, and we'll need it heated up. It's supposed to get, the temperature over the week is supposed to drop. And by next Saturday, Sunday, some are saying that it's going to be around 10 degrees. Some are saying that it's going to be around minus 10 degrees. And that's Fahrenheit, not Celsius. So it's going to be a cold, cold Christmas and a cold, cold Christmas Eve. Let's see here. Somebody knows. I was hoping somebody was sending me a text telling me what spam meant, but apparently they don't know. I'm hoping by now you have seen the new Watchmen broadcast. that I put out. I recorded it yesterday. That's what I stayed at home. And that's another thing. I years ago I built or I had built one of these tough shed barns on our property, and I put the idea was to put a studio in there so that if I'm home and I need to record something, I can just walk over there and do it. But when the fire happened, that whole thing got filled up with everything that we own. And it's been a slow process of getting everything out of it back into our house. And so, what was it, yesterday, day before yesterday, Saturday, something like that, I cleaned it out. I moved everything around, turned it back into a recording studio again. And then yesterday was able to get into there and record the Watchmen broadcast, which is Vatican Secrets Part 2. And I wanted to kind of go over that and just kind of discuss it in a little bit more depth today in the time that we're going to be online today. Let me put this on the screen. Let's swap it around and so on. And I have the full length video, I think. Let's see here. Where would it be? Ah, here it is. I think this is it. Yeah, there it is. The full length video of me driving out to the Il Retiro, St. John Vianney or Vianney Treatment Center. Let me figure out a way to cancel the volume out there. I was listening to some gospel tunes on the way out there, because you don't want to listen to rock and roll when you're going out to a place like that, and you don't want to listen to Gregorian chants either. Let me put that on the screen. Let's see here. I'm going to do this. Push that button, and here we go. And so this is, what I did was I put my camera. This is Highway 30. And I put my camera on the dashboard. And, of course, it was drizzling rain that day. And with it being on the dashboard, you know, it was vibrating a little bit. It was focusing more on the dashboard than it was on the road. But I changed that, but not until the camera slid all the way across the top of the dashboard because I was making a turn here. Something posed as meat. That's pretty good, Sister Kathy Uter. I don't think that's it, though. Now, the original SPAM that they came up with, SPAM stood for spiced ham. And they it was a cheap meat back then. Now it's expensive. But it was a cheap meat back then that they gave to World War II soldiers, and the soldiers loved it. But it was spiced ham. So I don't think it's something posed as, I don't think that's the reason why the phone call I get, Sister Kathy, is something posed as meat. I just don't think that. All right. Again, this is Highway 30 headed toward St. Clair, Missouri. It's eventually going to head toward, Interstate 44. This is how we go when we go to Interstate 44. There's the Dollar General there. Here, now, right here, see where the camera slid across the top of the... Let me back up a little bit. There used to be a sign right here that said Il Retiro. And since an article came out in the St. Louis Post-Dispatch back in 2006, and then since one of the local news stations, it might have been Fox 2, did a report on this place saying that it was full of pedophile priests, they took the sign down here. Because that's how I knew where it was to begin with. Years ago when I worked in construction, we had a job that took us down this road. And that Il Retiro, I recognized that it was Italian. And I thought, let's see, that Il means the. And so it's Italian for the Retiro. Then I kind of guessed that the word retiro, there's a lot of words in English that are similar to Spanish, French, Italian, words. So I figured that it had something to do with retire. So I thought may have been a retirement village or whatever. But my camera's going to slide across the top. I thought it was going to fall in the floorboard and I was going to wreck the car. So what I did was I stopped and I grabbed my tablet out of my backpack and I put my tablet on the dashboard and I put the camera on the tablet and looky there. Not only did it stabilize it, but it held it in place. Now, we've not gone too far at all down this particular road, and there's the first sign that you'll see, Il Retiro. And a squirrel is running towards the priest's retirement. Apparently, the squirrel doesn't know what danger he might be in. There's no telling what they use squirrels for out there. So, and it's not too far down this road. It's down in a hollow, between two hillsides. You have some signs up here along these trees. These people here that live here have posted signs going, this ain't it. If you're looking for a messed up priest, don't pull in our driveway to find one because there's none here. And it's just right around this corner here. And I'm going kind of slow because I want to get a good picture of. I probably could have pulled into the Il Retiro facility itself. I probably could have. Because as I mentioned in the Watchman broadcast, that part of the place, there it is, Il Retiro. Nice little picture there. Okay, Mike, keep driving. And I'm not worried about traffic at all because there's just no traffic down here. It's just going to be right around the corners, what that sign is telling you. And like I said, the place called Il Retiro is, there it is here, is how can I put it? It's like a little vacation place. I don't I don't think it's strictly for Catholic priests. In fact, let's do this here. They have a website. Here we go. Franciscan Retreat Center. And here's their advertisement. Whether you need a place to meet, a place to work, a place to gather your family. Not a good idea, people. Or simply take a few days to yourself and your creator. This is it. Il Retiro has accommodations for family gatherings. Not a good idea. They do not tell you on this website that right next door, and it's, I would say it's on the same property because it's owned by the same organization, the Catholic Church. They don't tell you on this website that right next door are some of the most dangerous people not in prison. Right next door. Family gatherings, business conferences, work groups, Bible studies, youth groups. Oh, yes. Please bring your youth groups out. And small private facilities as well. We are open and accepting reservations. Let's see here. If there was pictures. They have mass times, photo albums. Here we go. They have cabins. Pretty nice places. All with crucifixes in them. Let's see here. Oh, that's just repeating. They have a... let's see. What else do they have? Retreats. Need a breather from the hustle and bustle. Need to reconnect with God. Want to commune with nature. You want to make out with a priest. Plan your stay with us. Let's see here. From the director's desk. Blah, 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 blah. Accommodations and pricing. No pets. No meals provided at this time. In other words, bring your own food. St. Anthony House, St. Clair House, St. Francis. These are all saints. Reopening plan. But they are opening up for 2023. So let me go back to the video here. So this is the retreat center where families and youth groups are encouraged. Now, hang on back. Let me back up, back up, back up, back up, back up, back up, back up. All right. You see back in here? Back here is where all the pedophile priests are. Back here. That's how close they are to the retreat center. I have a map pulled up. Hang on, here it is. Let's see here. That's where I live. Let's see here. That's the big river. This B highway. B is going to run into 30. Here we go. This is highway 30. It's a It's a four-lane highway that comes out of St. Louis County off of Interstate 270. 270 is the loop around St. Louis. And right here is where it turns into a two-lane. And you follow it, you get to Dittmer Bible Church. And right here, okay, now watch this. Here is where we were just a second ago. Here is Il Retiro Franciscan Retreat Center. We came down Imy Road, and we stopped right here. And let me go to our video. This is where we're looking at right here. Now, right here, the Vianney Renewal Center. This here is the minimum security facility where the pedophile priests are. Looks like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, a main building here, 6, maybe 7, maybe that's like a shed or something like that. Let's add a satellite layer to that. There we go. That gives us a better idea. We were right here looking here. And we had the camera pointed this direction. Now, this is the Vianney Renewal Center. This is where they're keeping the priest. I had that verified both in news articles as well as the address of 5 currently registered sexual predators, which is public information. But I have a source at the Jefferson County Sheriff's Department, and they verified there was 6, and there's been as many as 7 or 8 registered sex offenders. Now, this facility houses as many as 40 men. The number of registered offenders only reflects those who have been adjudicated, judged by a court of law, and the judge ordered that their name be put on an offenders list. And the only place, in many cases, the judge will send the priest to this place for his punishment. I mean, it really looks like punishment, doesn't it? Now, the Il Retiro Franciscan Retreat has a lake. It has hiking paths, hiking trails. But notice, here's a trail here. See that trail? Watch and see what direction that trail points to. Right up here. So, let's say that one of these guys here wants to go on a walk. He takes the trail. Here's a little, I don't know, an open area here, like a grotto or something like that. Wants to go down to the lake and do some fishing. And there is a group of families or a boys' retreat. People, it's not good. Now, let me keep playing this video. I knew there was another building down here, so I pull out and I go down here. This is the Vianney Renewal Center. And notice that the Vianney Renewal Center, in a minute I'm going to turn the camera. There you go. No trespassing private property. 24-hour camera surveillance. Right next to a retreat center for families, boys groups, girls groups, etc., etc. I sit there trying to figure out where to go next. Now I have another video I want to play, and this is gonna knock your hat in the creek. I'm going back out to Highway 30. And see this building right here? That is, I think it's a Lutheran church. And I think they have a school there. But what you can't see, there's courses where Jesus lives. What you can't see is right across from this Lutheran church is... In 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, Maple. Is it Maplewood or Maple Grove Elementary School? Now, what I did was I turned around and I looked at the clock. No, I didn't look at the clock. I looked at the odometer on my car to see how far away this school was. And again, I think this is a Lutheran church, and I think it has a school. It's got the buildings for it. I know that. So we're going to drive back, and I'm looking at my odometer. Look at your watch. Okay, so I got 5 seconds. I got 10 seconds now. I got 15. I got 20 seconds. 25 seconds. Got to stop at a stop sign. And it's a dangerous stop sign. There's very little disability to your left there. And I ran this stop sign, I'm pretty sure. No, I ran it once. I know that. So now we are 45 seconds. We are at 55 seconds. We are at 1 minute. Minute 5. A minute 10. Minute 15. There's the Il Retiro sign telling you turn here. We're at a minute 30. And we're at a minute 45. Minute 50. 55. 2 minutes. And I'm doing less than 30 miles an hour. A minute 5, a minute 10, or actually 2. 2:15. 2:15. And let's see here. 30 seconds. And we are almost there. But I was looking at my odometer the whole time. And from that elementary school, to this place here and the buildings next to it is just right at a mile. Then, of course, you have to stop and you have to pray to St. Francis, because it's a Franciscan camp. The Franciscan monks run this. And see, there's the building right there where the pedophiles are. I mean, that's how close they are. That's how close they are to the Family and Children's Retreat Center. They are less than a mile from a public elementary school and possibly a Lutheran elementary school. And like I say, people have been up in arms for years over this. And the Archbishop Raymond Burke, he's not the Archbishop of St. Louis anymore, but in the article that I read in the Watchman broadcast, Archbishop Edmund Burke was praising this place because it's a place where some of these priests begged to go. They wanted to go there because they wanted a place that would watch over them and make sure that they never did anything like this ever again. However, since it's been in operation, at least one priest that we know for sure went to prison for molesting a child while he was at that center. Another priest got brought up on charges of possessing and attempting to spread children's images over the internet from the Vianney Renewal Center. If it's meant to be a place of monitoring and a place where these men can get some help and a place that is going to teach them a lesson, don't you ever do this again. It doesn't seem to be working very well. And I don't understand. I don't understand how, if your average Joe on the street, if he molests over 100 children, which is what some of these guys are there for. He doesn't get to go to a minimum security facility where he has access to television, where he has access to the internet, where he can go for walks. I don't get it. I don't get it. And here's my biggest, one of my biggest problems. This is why, if you want to know why, we had a situation a while back where a young lady who attended this church was being molested by her stepdad. When this young lady contacted me, I had a report filled out online to the child abuse hotline within an hour of being told this. And the reason why it took me an hour was I was getting all the information from this young lady. Okay, what's his name? Where does he work? What's his phone number? What's your address? I was getting information to fill out, you know, how exactly, you know, what's your birthday, things like that. I was getting all the information I needed from her through text messages to get all the information filled out on the online report. If I would have already known all that stuff, it would have only taken me 15 minutes to fill out the report from the time I heard it. But it only took me an hour, and within an hour, I had this guy turned in. And it's because this young lady, this young girl, felt comfortable enough with her pastor that she could tell me these things and know that something would be done about it. In the Catholic Church system, the priest is Godhead. He is the Father. He is Christ in the place of Christ. And he is Paraclete, the Helper, the Holy Spirit. The priest is Godhead. And so there was one instance where a young lady, a girl, was telling her parents about a priest at her school who was molesting her. She told her parents several times that this was going on. Her parents decided to take her to the bishop, a high-ranking priest. Do you know what this bishop did? This bishop put a little pillow down on the floor with her parents in the room and told the young girl when her parents said, tell the bishop, honey, what you told us. When she told the bishop what the priest had been doing to her, the bishop pointed to the pillow and said, get down on your knees and confess to me, to your parents, and to God that you are lying about this priest. And she said, no. I'm telling you the truth. And that priest wore her down until she got down on her knees, bawling her eyes out until she confessed that what she said was a lie. And as far as from that moment on, it's over with. You see, even if they would have pursued it with the police, all the bishop would have to do is say, look, the girl came in my office and in front of her parents said that she had been lying. Case over with. Case is over with. That bishop knew exactly what to do. He knew that if he could get that girl to recant her story in his presence and in front of her parents, that even if they went to the police and a trial was held, all he would have to do is bring this story out that the girl got in my office and admitted that she was lying, admitted that she made the whole thing up. Case over with. That, listen, that bishop had done that before. Guarantee you, that wasn't the first time that he ever did something like that. I asked Michael if this goes on in Kenya, and he said, oh, yeah, it's bad. It's very bad. And I said, is it with black priests or white priests? He said, a lot of the priests in Kenya are sent from Italy. They're Italian. So is the Vatican going to believe the story of an Italian priest over the story of a poor third world, quote unquote, ignorant child? They're going to believe the priest every time. I am imploring all of those who are listening to me, and I believe that it is possible that I or our church or our ministry in Kenya, my family, may in fact incur the wrath of the harlot of Rome herself by saying this. But I implore all of the people that I love in Samburu and Turkana, Kenya, and wherever my voice can be heard, leave the Catholic Church. Leave it. You have a man standing over you who tells you that he is Godhead. And I have up on the screen the exact catechism teaching. And it says, in the ecclesial service of the ordained minister, it is Christ himself who is present to his church as head of the body, shepherd of his flock, high priest of the redemptive sacrifice, teacher of truth. Now, as far as that goes, that's what I believe about Jesus Christ. I don't believe it about me. And I certainly don't believe it out of any other man. However, let me continue reading. According to the Catechism, this is what the church means by saying that the priest, by virtue of the sacrament of holy orders, acts, and here's a Latin phrase, in persona Christi capitis, which means in the person of Christ the head. In other words, when a priest is ordained to the priesthood in the Catholic Church, he's ordained by an archbishop. He now has all of the powers of Jesus Christ. He now is the head of the church body. He is the shepherd of that flock. He is the high priest of the redemptive sacrifice. When he holds that wafer in his hand and says, in hoc est, in hoc est meum corpus, this is my body. He believes, and the church believes, that he now is the high priest making the sacrifice all over again of Jesus Christ. That is blasphemy. The book of Hebrews says that Christ only died once. He only suffered once. He only paid the price for sins one time only. And you have priests who are sacrificing Jesus every single day. And it just, it angers me. It angers me. I have a Savior who, to start out, he's praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. And he is sweating drops of blood. He is in such agony that blood is coming out of the pores of his skin. Then he hears Roman soldiers. And among those Roman soldiers is one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, who comes to him, kisses him, and says, "My Lord." Jesus knew that that was Judas betraying him to the Roman soldiers, pointing out who he was. So the Roman soldiers go over to Jesus. They tie him up or put him in cuffs or whatever, and they lead him off. And from that moment forward, he doesn't sleep. He is taken before the Sanhedrin, which is the Jewish elders, 70 of them. The very men that Moses established to be the rulers of Israel, 70 men. And every one of them hate him so bad They blindfolded him, and they would go up and they would punch him in the face and say, "Tell me who, if you're the Son of God, and you can see all these things, tell us who it was that hit you." And he said, "Not a word." Then they took the clothes off his back and took a scourge and scourged his back. And then they put the robe back on him, took sticks with thorns on them. And, buddy, I tell you what, I used to run through the woods enough behind my house when I was a boy. And when we ran into what we called a sticker bush or a sticker tree, we knew it. And, buddy, that hurt. They took those things, and they didn't just gently lay it on his head. They tapped it down into his skin. Then they spit in his face. The Old Testament says that they plucked his beard out. The Bible says he was marred more than any man. Then they ripped the robe back off of him, opening the wounds again that had congealed and clotted, put a cross of wood on him that was so heavy that a man in his full strength would have trouble carrying that to the cross. Jesus stumbled and fell. So they compelled Simon of Cyrene to come and help him carry the cross. I'd like to meet that man. Because you see, and I'm speaking to all our friends in Kenya, Simon of Cyrene was a black man like you are. And he had the blessing of helping Jesus carry the cross to Calvary. I can't wait to meet him. They put him on that cross, drove nails in his hands, in his feet, and hung him up. And for 9 hours, he suffocated. Probably the only worst way to die is by burning. So he's suffocating for 9 hours. They were going to come around and break his legs, but he had already died. A Roman soldier took a spear and thrust it into his, I believe it was his left side, because that's where the heart is and the pericardium. Because the Bible says that water and blood issued forth, and I believe it was probably right here under the fifth rib, and it broke open that sack of water around the heart so that the water and the blood issued forth. The ground opened her mouth to receive the blood, just like Abel. And when the Catholic priest believes that he forces Jesus' suffering all over again in the sacrifice of the Mass, it makes me angry. Because what you're saying is Christ's suffering at Calvary was not good enough. That's what you're saying. and that it takes the priest, who is now the high priest, it takes him to finish the act that Christ left unfinished by crucifying himself to himself afresh, the Son of God. There is a, I tell you what, there's a verse of scripture that stands directly in opposition to every false doctrine of the Catholic Church. Let me read this. This is Hebrews 6, verse 4. For it is impossible for those who were once enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift and were made partakers of the Holy Ghost and have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the world to come, if they shall fall away, to renew them again unto repentance, seeing that they crucify to themselves the Son of God afresh and put him to an open shame. And that's not a good thing. God's not saying, see, that's a good thing, but it, you know, you can't do that. It's wrong to bring Christ to an open shame again. This is why every crucifix in the world is an abomination to God. Number one, because it has an idol on it. And God did not say, you shall not make images of false gods. God said, thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image. Any of them. You should not bow down to them. You don't pray to them. And every time a Catholic walks into their church and sees the crucifix, they genuflect, which means they bow, they cross themselves, because they're paying respect to a piece of wood or a piece of stone. And does a crucifix hear your prayers? Does the crucifix save you? That's actually part of Catholic teaching, that if you die wearing a crucifix, then you can have a lot of your sins forgiven at the time of your death. This is why when you see someone who is Catholic in their casket, they're seen holding their rosary, which has a crucifix on it. Because according to Catholic doctrine, that gives them less time in purgatory, which does not exist. It does not exist. I love you people. And I'm speaking to our Kenyan friends. If I didn't love you, we wouldn't be on the radio station. It's costing us a fortune to operate two radio stations in Kenya. And we don't get any advertising money from that. We don't get government subsidy for that. We don't. And if I didn't love you, I wouldn't be sending people out with bags of food to keep you alive. And if I didn't love you, then I would say to you, it doesn't matter what church you go to, as long as you go to a church somewhere. But I'm not saying that. I'm saying to all of our friends in Kenya that the Catholic Church exists to steal your goods, your money, your children, and eventually your soul. They take, but they seldom give. So when the Catholic Church and the priests in Turkana intervened in a legal contract that we had with an office complex to rent radio station space, and some Catholic priests came by and told the owner of the building, cast Eka Yokan Radio out of those offices. We're going to use them to store food. That's exactly what happened. We had a contract. The contract was not up. But those priests came to the building owner and had us cast out of our own offices, even though we had paid our rent and we had a contract. And they said, we need this space to store food. Now, I initially questioned the fact that they were going to store anything there. I didn't think they were going to store food there. Well, they actually did. But you should have seen me when I found out that all the food that they stored there, they let it rot. It was full of corn. It was full of maize. And they let it rot so that in one of the worst famines in Turkana history, the Catholic Church should have had plenty of food to give out to people all over the land. But because they refused to release the food, they let it rot and it all had to be burnt. That's the church that you want to defend. The church that brings your wife into a secret box called the confessional. And when the priest feels like she hasn't confessed enough sins, he starts questioning her. Are you sure you've confessed all of your sins? Yes, Father. Are you really sure? Well, of course, Father. And the priest says, what about sins of lusting after another man? Have you committed that sin? Well, yes, Father, I have. Then the priest will begin to question her about what she was lusting about that other man? What were you wanting to do with this other man? Tell me how often you have lusted after this other man. Tell me what you wanted to do with this other man. And listen, if you think I'm making this up, I'm not. There is a whole list of questions that priests are demanded to tell. They are commanded to tell by their superiors in the confessional to get right down to the heart of the most wickedest, vilest thoughts and imaginations of the human heart. And here is a man now. Here is a man who is a bachelor. He is unmarried, meaning he does not have the benefit of having a wife to satisfy his needs. And so his only alternative is to basically turn your wife or your daughter into his whore. And I guarantee you, he will. What about you men? What about you men? Have you not sat in that confessional booth while that priest grilled you on the number of times you gratified yourself, on the number of times where you lusted after some other woman? Have you not experienced that? Do you think that he withholds himself when a woman or a teenage girl, or worse, a 10-year-old girl comes into the confessional? Do you think that he withholds himself? No. This man is an evil human being. And the problem of priests luring girls, women, boys into all manner of adultery and fornication, it is rampant. I would say that probably 9 out of every 10 Catholic priests have violated their vows of celibacy. And that's the priests, the bishops, the archbishops, the cardinal archbishops, and the popes. Guarantee you. Because it is not possible for the vast majority of men to speak of things that between a man and a woman should never be spoken of, and it not affect both of them. I mean, I want you to stop and think about it. Here is a man who does not have the benefit of having a wife because he's been forbidden by his church. And they don't plan on changing it. There is no talk of changing this anywhere. And this is really the problem. He has made a vow of celibacy that he himself cannot, by his own will, keep that vow. And then your wife or your daughter is going to go into a private chamber with him. Doors locked. So that there's no way you can hear what's going on. And you're led to believe that all he's doing is forgiving her sins. But that's not what he's doing. He is looking for his next easy victim. There's a story in a lot of the research that I've done. A young a priest was sent out of a Catholic church because of allegations of child abuse. Part of that secret shuffle that I was talking about. He was sent out of that particular church and sent to another one. And they bring in another priest. A family who had been attending that church. I'm not sure if they had a Christian school. I don't know if it was on a Sunday or what. But they went to the church to meet the new priest. And you know what the young man said? He was probably about 10 or 11 at the time. Do you know what he said? Now, he's an adult now. You know what he said? He was asked by the reporter, did this new priest abuse you? And he said, yeah. And the reporter said, how long was it from the time that he got there and you first met him until he abused you? He said, within the first hour. The boy shows up, and before an hour passes, that priest has already abused that boy. The new priest. See, you shuffle him around, but all you're doing is taking one pedophile out and putting him in a church and bringing another pedophile from another church and bringing him to this church. That's all they're doing. The secret shuffle. And again, I am appealing to our friends in Kenya, where I bet that it is a lot easier to get by with this in a third world country than it is someplace like America. And they're getting by with it in America easily. America, Canada, Europe. But you get into third world countries like Peru, Colombia, Mexico, Argentina. You get into third world countries like that. Kenya, Uganda, Nigeria, you get into third world countries like that. Who's going to believe those children? When that man has established himself as Godhead, which means to them, you can't speak against them. You can't complain about them. You can't accuse them. Because if you're not careful, You could be like that poor girl who was made to get on that pillow and yell and scream at her until she finally confessed that she was lying. But she wasn't lying. He made her lie. The result would be that you get excommunicated from the church. And if you're a Catholic, you know what that means, don't you? If you're an excommunicated Catholic, there is zero chance that you're going to heaven. Zero. And what a shame it is. Because we have a high priest that we go directly to. His name is Jesus Christ. And Jesus said, "All that come to me, I will in no wise cast out." Even if you've been mad at Jesus and taken his name in vain and cursed him, he still loves you. And he won't make you get out on your knees and lie just to make him look good. He'll take you as you are. He will forgive all of your sins if you'll ask him. And he will make you a new creature. He won't tell you, "I demand that you must be a better person." He won't tell you that. He'll say, "If you'll come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light." He won't demand of you that you change. He'll just simply ask you to trust him, and he will change you. Oh, I hope and pray our Catholic friends in Kenya, Uganda, wherever we're heard, all over the world, would hear what the Lord has to say to them. They know that priest is evil. They know that priest is dirty. And I'm not asking you to join my religion. I'm asking you to join the true religion. And that is, call upon the name of Jesus. Be saved today. And then God will show you I love you. You're the reason why we do what we do. Pray for us here. Let me say this. We're asking for something bigger than anything we've ever asked for. We would like to have, if you know of somebody has used ambulances, that they would like to donate to our ministry. We'll worry about getting them to Kenya. Used ambulances, because there are not enough medical services there in Turkana to get people to the hospital. So if you know of somebody who has a used ambulance, I don't know if it has to be in a certain shape or what. Maybe we can get it running. I don't know. But if you know of somebody that has a used ambulance, okay, let us know. Okay, give us a call, area code 636-931-399. Ask for Alicia. and she'll give you the details. Also, we want to do a feeding for Christmas for the people in Turkana. The biggest one yet. I never ask for money. I'm not going to ask now. I am going to ask you to help us pray that God will bless us and we will be able to do the biggest feeding that we've ever done in time for Christmas this year in Turkana. Okay? That's what I'm asking for. Lord bless you. I love you. We'll see you later, alligator.